Thank you for coming today. I appreciate it. Two reasons why this is really nice. One, it's the last one, and two, it's April 13th. And the first one we did was way back in October, so it's kind of nice to know that we're winding down the semester, and I appreciate that you taking your time to come and learn a little bit about ergonomics. And hopefully you can take home and take back to your office some of the things that you learned today. And if you're having pain, I'm looking out here and seeing how some of you are sitting, and I can see why you might be having some pain.
I was just thinking that. I might fall.
It's this motion. So we'll talk about that. We'll see why. I'll show you why it's causing you pain, and hopefully we can correct a few things and enjoy the next half hour, 45 minutes or so. Just by way of introduction, my name is Craig Hackett. If those of you don't know me, I've had about 21 years now. Next week will be 21 years. I just got a LinkedIn, somebody from LinkedIn somewhere sent a thing, said happy anniversary on your job, and I thought, so I guess it's been 21 years. That I've had clinical experience. I've worked in a rehab setting here in the Gila Valley at Roadrunner Rehab. Part of that experience, we went out to offices and even to homes and talked to people about how they live their lives, what they do, and try to make it better so that they feel better. And a lot of times it's just mechanics. We get into a habit and we find ourselves doing things because it's just what we do. It's where our dishes are. It's where our desk is. It's where our computer is. And we do things out of habit, and eventually it causes pain. That pain becomes chronic, which is good for business. It really is good for business, but it's not so good for you. It's good for our business, and as we look at some of the reasons why this is an important topic, you'll find the reason why I'm here today and why I'm teaching this. I was the head athletic trainer here for about 4 years. I did that while working over at Roadrunner Rehab, so it was a bit of, it took all my time. So I had to make a choice, stayed at Roadrunner for a few years, and I've been here now about 3. So thank you, EAC, for allowing me to come back, your wayward son. I appreciate it. Ergonomics, somewhere we went wrong. We're heading back in the wrong direction. According to the U.S. Time Use Survey, adults spend up to 10 hours a day sitting in front of a screen, whether that's here at work, a screen, or at home. We spend up to 10 hours a day. The World Health Organization estimates that 95% of adults worldwide are failing to be active, and that's only 30 minutes a day, 3 to 5 days a week. They said 5 days a week for a while, but the World Health Organization said, we're never going to get there. That's adults worldwide, so we're talking about lots of different cultures and populations and what we're doing. We do fairly well here in the United States, but still the percentage is fairly high that we don't exercise enough. So we spend 10 hours sitting. We're spending somewhere between 6 and 8 hours laying in a bed, and then the rest of the time it's driving in a car or, you know, adjusting our seats, if you will. Very little of that time is spent in actual exercise. The health benefits include a lower risk of premature death, coronary heart disease, lower risk of stroke, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, and depression. So should we exercise? Yeah. But we still have to work. We still have to earn a living. And if that requires us to sit at a desk, we better learn to do it in a way that's not going to hurt us so that we can perform our proper functions. So let's look at pain, and what kind of pain are we having? Well, those pictures on the slide fairly well represent what we're dealing with when we're on the job. Headaches account for 5.4% of pain, back pain 3.2%, arthritis and musculoskeletal pain 2% of the population at work. That's just work pain. What does that mean as far as productivity hours? Well, that means that headaches cost us 3.5 hours a week, back pain is 5.2 hours a week, and all other combined is 5.5 hours a week. So if you're at work and you're in pain, productivity goes down. That's why we're here. So if we can keep your pain away, we'll make you more productive at work. And not only do we get the job done, but we get a job done well. And isn't that what we really want to do? We want to perform well. That cost comes out to about $61.2 billion a year. That's 76% of lost productivity. And that is contributed to reduced performance and not absence. That's just reduced performance. So people are here, they're just not productive. So we need to get better at what we're doing. It can all be contributed to poor posture and prolonged posturing. In other words, sitting at a desk. So let's look at some of the specifics for headaches and upper back pain and why it happens. Headaches occur because of the musculature in our neck. If you look at the red zones there, they're all connected, although they may not be connected on the screen. Our bodies are an amazing thing, and it's a good thing. There are lots of possibilities with this amazingly functioning body. But when we sit poorly for an extended period of time, we can cause stress in muscles, typically in our upper back and neck. And when that happens, it pulls on the muscle in the base of our skull, right in here, and that muscle is attached by a tissue to the front. So when we have tension headaches or we have stress headaches, typically in the front of our head, it's starting from here in the base of our skull. A lot of that is postural. As I look around the room, some of you have now started to use your entire seat, which is good. Before, I saw somebody on their phone, and so their hands were out, stretching their traps, and then their head was forward and down, putting your 8-pound head out there on a lever, increasing tension. It's a give or take. Depends on how much air is in there and
how much. Six,
Lord. Okay. 6 to 8 and a half. And if we stay in that posture and we don't change, we continue to add load to that. As our muscles fatigue, we look for other muscles to contribute to help support our head and support our upper back. It gets worse and worse. We begin to what we call in the business a cascade, and it leads to the front of the neck. Our scalene muscles start to hurt, pulling our shoulders forward, adding to more tension in the upper neck. And before you know it, we've got chronic headaches, even when we're not here. And that, of course, doesn't lead to happy family life or home life or any other life. So we've got to look at head and neck pain and change our posture. And what about back pain? Well, we have to support the curve in our lower back. We're designed like a spring. And the picture in the lower, your lower right, on this side, shows that nice curve in the spine. Well, they tip their pelvis to get there, okay? And as you tip your pelvis, your muscles in your bottom, your glutes, go on stretch. And they attach up at the lower back. And as that tissue starts to tense up, it tells the lower back, hey, I need some help. And those lower back muscles tend to tense up. And before you know it, we begin that cascade effect once again. Because we're sitting, and we're usually supported at the arms, either on the chair or at the desk, our ab muscles don't have to kick in that hard. So we start to weaken in our abdominal muscles. That begins to rotate our pelvis even more, causing more abnormal curve into our spine without support. Once again, adding to more of the effect of muscle soreness and tightness in our lower back. We'll talk about how we help with that. As those muscles tighten down, they begin to influence other things like nerves. And some of you have heard of sciatic pain. I love it when people call it sciatica. It reminds me of a prison in upstate New York. And it really is that. That kind of pain does become sort of a prison. People spend a majority of their time thinking about it and talking about it and trying to relieve it, and it becomes consuming. There's nothing sadder for me than when somebody comes into the clinic that's had chronic sciatic pain because of poor posturing, and they've been dealing with it for years and years and haven't sought help. They've tried to self-diagnose and self-treat, and if we can just give them a few things early, it would have prevented years of chronic pain. Sciatics, when we joke about it, but sciatic and sciatica is a very severe thing, and we can get rid of it. We can take care of that, and it doesn't take much as long as we catch it early. So. Yeah, the hips need to drop down and we need to support our lower backs. And I'll show you some pictures here in a little bit what that's supposed to look like. Don't worry, I'm not going to just show you the problems. I'll actually show you the solutions too. We'll just end it right at the problems and go home and think about it. Carpal tunnel. Yep. Carpal tunnel is once again a postural issue, and it stems from the nerve being entrapped within the carpal tunnel of your wrist. It affects the use of your hands. If it gets severe, the ability to feel and the ability to be dexterous with your fingers, lose your dexterity in your fingers. Typing becomes a problem. Of course, the chronic pain is an issue. It all stems from proper support of the elbows. That also leads to, it follows up the arm and gets back up into your neck. So as we try to adjust and move our hands and put our hands in different positions, it can affect our neck as well. So carpal tunnel, we try to readjust so much to the point where we're actually going to cause other significant problems in our posture. This is another one that, some people just have a small tunnel. And if you type for a living, then most likely, you may develop that. There are some things that you can do to help prevent, and it really is a matter of prevention. Once you start to build up the pressure in that tunnel and lay down scar tissue and thicken tendons within that tunnel, it's kind of a downhill slope from there. So this is something that we probably ought to teach our students how to properly sit and how to properly use their hands at a desk. I have a feeling that over the years, we're going to see more problems with that because of this motion right here. We'll see. They're still young, so we'll see. We'll have to wait a few years on that study. So we'll see if we have greater issues with carpal tunnel. We can look at keyboard design for this, and we will here in a minute. Typically, hand dominance with your mouse. We talk about trading sides with a mouse. We'll look at that. And unsupported forearms from your chair. And I know that we can look at a chair and try to fix the chair, but if the chair doesn't slide under the desk, we could have another issue. So it does get a little complicated, and we'll look at that. So what exactly can be done about these things? Because isn't that why we're here, trying to figure out what we can do? Well, back in the day, this is all we had. And at the time, it was fairly effective. Lots of places to put papers, and everything was a paper at the time. Fairly good arm support. It was up high. They didn't do a lot of typing. It was more writing. People got up and down out of their chairs a lot more. Messages were delivered by hand instead of sent by electronics. It took a little bit more effort, I think. And maybe productivity wasn't as high. But that's all they had. And we've gotten better. We've gotten a lot better. This was what my office looked like. I don't know if you can see that very well through the projector, but those are cardboard boxes. The first couple of weeks I was working here, some of the staff thought it would be funny to move my desk and put cardboard boxes in my office, and it was quite funny. They actually thought I did a practical joke on Mr. DeLeo, but it wasn't me. I don't know why they accused me of it. It must be something I did in my past, but they took the desk out of my office and put cardboard boxes in there. And it looked just like that. I found my desk in the bathroom across the hall, which might not be a bad place for it. So where have we gotten to? Well, that's what it's looking like nowadays. Anybody want to set up like that? How about the one up here in the top right? Looks like a dentist chair, huh? But look at that. Feet are up, shoes are off. Where's the drink?
Hey, that must be Dr. Skinner. You got his boots off.
She doesn't look like she's doing much. She's just kind of thinking about what she's going to write. But this is what we've gotten to. Some of these can be practical. Others are just probably a dream, like the one up there on your top right. But all of them are supportive. I mean, look what's happening here. We've got lumbar support. Her head's in a good neutral position. She can adjust the chair, which is important, because even if you're in a supportive position, it's going to get old. You're going to want to move. So by moving the footrest away, by lowering and raising the desk, or sitting up in the chair, all of it allows you to be supported but still be able to change position, which is wonderful. It's awfully expensive to get chairs like this. It really is. So somehow we have to learn to make do with what we've got. Obviously, the one on the top right goes to the extreme. And the only thing missing there is not only her drink, but the motor on the chair, right? So she can wheel herself down the hall into the elevator, and then someone can carry her to her car. The one here at the bottom, I've seen, actually, and some of the setups are pretty close to this. As you notice, she doesn't have a back to her chair, but because of the position that she's in, she's actually supported through her hips, which is what we do all the time anyway. As the old saying goes, I am thankful for my legs. They've always supported me. And she's being supported. Her hands are at a rest position, and the desk is inclined. She probably could do with a little bit more elbow support. She's probably a little bit high. My guess is this person here is a receptionist or something, up and moving quite a bit, and so doesn't have to have necessarily a desk that she needs to sit at. Not a bad idea to have something like that. Once again, it kind of fits what your needs are. And we can make do with what you've got, too. We just need to look at it. Some of the keyboard changes that they've made in the last few years, some of you have split keyboards. A lot of them separate even further, like the one on the bottom right to you. You can spread it out and keep put your hands in a relaxed position. If your hands are large or you have wider shoulders, sometimes a normal keyboard isn't sufficient. You have to really bring your hands in and close together. Typing class was miserable for me in high school. I have, you know, not overly large hands, but large, and it was tough to get them all on that home row. With a split keyboard, it would have been a lot more comfortable. And I wouldn't be using three fingers like I do today. I might be using all of them. It just, yeah.
They have too many things.
And there's only, you have, and they're getting the making, they're making the phones bigger, and you can turn them sideways.
Okay, yeah.
My favorite keyboard of all is this one. Has anyone tried this one yet? You can actually turn it on its ends and put your hands onto its side and type. No one's tried it yet?
I'm sorry, that would just fry my brain.
You know what? I bet you get used to it pretty quick.
So totally rethink.
Wouldn't that be so good for you, though,
to challenge yourself?
Just not during accreditation. You can do it.
Yeah.
Now that that's over, go ahead and do that crazy keyboard. So they've made a lot of changes. They've made it with equipment that we can use. If we can't buy specialty equipment like we've just seen, there are a few things that we can do, even at our own desks, that can help. And I've listed six of them here. These aren't the only six, but these are helpful. The top of the monitor should be at your forehead height, which allows you to look slightly down at your monitor. Your eyes take a lot more work to look up. They naturally tend to drift just slightly down from the position. So if your monitor is just about the size at the height of your forehead, you'll actually look down in the spot. And decreasing eye tension, which helps, of course, with headaches, and that's helpful. Your visual field, like I said, should be slightly downward. Forearms and wrists should be supported. And in this case, they're using the arm of the chair, which is really good. This one, of course, looks like it's in a locked, fixed position. Most of them now adjust up and down, and they angle in and out. You can go one higher than the other if you want to. You can adjust them that way. Once again, it's support and comfort. If you find that the support isn't comfortable, you may have to readjust and maybe not use the arm, but maybe use a pad or slide your chair underneath the desk and use the desk, moving your keyboard further away. Whatever it takes to get your arm supported, remember, we're trying to prevent carpal tunnel and tension issues in the upper neck with support of the elbows. Use the entire chair, including the backrest. A nice look around. Once again, people are moving, so that's fine. But when I say the whole chair, that means your bottom is touching. And these desk chairs aren't too bad. They actually have a little bit of a curve to it. And I can see that some of you are not doing it. So let's have everybody just kind of slide back real quick. And I know you don't want to. No one likes to be told what to do. Slide back and kind of put your bottom right into that and just use it. And you can see that for a few minutes, that's going to be pretty good. But how long can you do it? Especially because now, where are your arms? Some of you are close enough to the desk where you can rest. But because now your arms are hanging, other things, you're going to start to slowly rock forward anyway, putting tension in your upper back. So the whole chair idea is good if arms are supported. Yeah, that's better. And see, the desk's still a little high for you because your shoulders went, whoop.
It's really tough to be short.
Yeah.
Setups.
And what they don't have down here is where your feet, and we'll talk about that in a second. So, all right, go ahead and relax, at ease, go wherever you want to sit. Slide back down in that chair, half leaning over, that's fine. Knees should be a finger span, some say three, I've read it different ways. But you should be able to put comfortably your hand or a finger between your knee and the chair. And the reason for that is it'll right at that junction in the back of your knee, we have arteries and a vein, and it'll pinch with pressure on the end of your chair. You can tip your chair forward just a little bit, not too much, you'll feel like you're slide, and that'll relieve it as well. So if you find that you're getting sciatic pain or your lower legs are going numb, your toes, typically it's your pinky toes that go first, If they're starting to feel tingly, it may be because your seats, if you're shorter in stature, your seat may be a little bit long and you're compressing the nerve. That tingling, my feet are asleep feeling, is the nerve compression. So when people say I need to increase my circulation, that's part of it because the nerve travels along that artery, but it is a nerve that's being compressed. So make sure that your seat position is proper.
So again, for those of us that are doggone short,
yeah.
Okay, a chair is not made for that short a span.
Right.
So should I be thinking about something that moves
right.
me forward but still has the back support?
Right. You can use the back support on some chairs actually slide forward for you. And if that doesn't work, we have tried at in the clinic just rolled up towels to see if that works first. And you usually use two and put them long ways on the chair. So instead of putting it sideways where it's giving you more lumbar support than you probably need, right? Because if you need 6 inches, 6 inches of lumbar support may not be appropriate for you. So put them long ways so that your whole back is up against it. And if that works, then you can actually buy a cushion or they make products that actually give you that depth.
Okay.
And some of them are pretty neat. They look like they might fit in like a off-road racer. They kind of curve around you. So they're kind of like a sand buggy. Yeah. Just in case, you know, you get bumped, you don't slide out of your chair. So you can do that. Yeah. So you can't do much about the seat, but you can do something about the backrest and how much space is behind you. Feet. Feet should be flat on the floor with equal weight through the heels and the toes. I know a lot of us like to do this thing where we hook our feet around each other. We like to rest our feet on the wheels of the chair, and that's fine. If you cannot reach the floor, that's an issue because once again, your feet are now hanging. So constantly having your knees bent, you're decreasing the space between the chair and your knee will cause that nerve to be compressed. If your feet are getting cold, that may be another sign. So make sure that your feet can touch the floor. If they can't touch the floor, then we can put a block or a step underneath. I've seen some that actually move with you. I've actually seen a lady that worked for the city had pedals. She liked to pedal while it was down there. To each their own, I guess. But it was just a little fixed bike. So those are just six suggestions that you can do at the desk, just seated at the desk. So what about your work zones? Many of you are very busy. And I know that what some of your desks look like, with papers over here, two or three screens in front of you, and some more papers over there, and a filing cabinet over here. So we got to look at work zones so that we're not overreaching. If you're going to spend that much time at a desk, keep things that are really important close and put the things that aren't so important a little further away. And the reason you do that is the more that you're doing this thing in a seated position, forward flexed, and you're constantly doing a repetitive motion to your shoulder blade and upper neck, you're going to increase the tension of those muscles. They're great muscles. They are really strong. They're not great endurance muscles. So they're really good for pulling stuff. They're not good for just repetitive motion. 1,000 years from now, we may adapt. But at this point, we're stuck with what we got as far as the way our muscles work, especially in our upper back and neck. So with that being said, I'm sorry about the clarity. Make sure that your repetitive or primary work zone are within these gray areas. As you notice, they overlap. So right in front of you should be where your primary work is. So if you're a keyboarder, your keyboard is obviously right there. Okay, that doesn't mean your screens are over here and you're turning your head to see your screen. Anybody stuck like that in their office where they have to move their desk over? They like their monitor in the corner and they're sitting straight against their desk? Not this time around? Okay, we had one last time. All right, so make sure the screen is in front of you too because you'll need to look up. You'll need to see what you're doing. The occasional access or secondary work zones are just a little bit further out but within a hand's reach, so an arm's length. So you should be able to pull those papers in or documents that you need. Those are your secondary work zones. And seldom access are up and away. They're either up and away from the desk or out of hand's reach, something you'll probably have to get up and get to. So if you find that you've, and most of us do this, it's just natural, it comes natural, the things that we do the most are closest to us, but if you find that your paper clips or your pen or whatever your supplies that you need pretty consistently through the day are up and away and out of hand's reach, and you probably ought to move those closer to you. Either put them in a drawer closer by so you're not overreaching and causing repetitive motions in your upper back and neck. Okay.
I don't think so.
The last few committees I was in, I wish we had done this. To be honest, I needed it. So we have to move, though. Our problem is we spend 10 hours a day seated. Okay, whether at home or at work, we're on our bottoms a lot, and we're not exercising, we're not moving. So are there some things that we can do at work? Yeah, there's just simple things that we can do. Is it going to increase our heart rate? Probably not tremendously, but hey, we're well-dressed, and most of us are wearing heels, so probably isn't something that we want to do anyway. So there are just a few simple things that we can do to get our bodies moving, to get our muscles to contract and to stretch out so that we're not stuck in that same repetitive motion over and over and over again. It's just like the tires on your car. If they're out of kilter and we're driving on them, they're going to wear out in that one spot. Same thing with our muscles and joints. So let's move them around quite a bit. And it doesn't have to look like this. Oh, wouldn't that be nice?
Thank you.
I mean, I can just imagine a few of our administrators. Anyway. Especially the one at the end. I love the one at the end where she's got her foot up on the desk.
Yeah, there's no way.
That'd be awesome. Okay. All right, let's stand up. We got to stand up. I know you're in for it. A couple of simple exercises you can do. Just stand up, move around behind your chair. You can use the chair for balance if you think you need to. And you're just going to go up on your toes and back down again. Now, why do we do that? Well, our feet are farthest away from our heart than anything else. Okay? And they do a pretty good job of recirculating that blood back to our heart. All right? But it needs a little help. We've got these really wonderful things called muscles in our lower extremities. And every time we go up and down like that, we're getting a pumping action through our muscles that actually helps squeeze the blood back up into our bigger muscles in our legs and in our hips, which helps it get back to our heart a little bit easier. So our heart doesn't have to work as hard, which is kind of nice. Okay, so that's just one, right? If you want to make it harder, you can go out to the side and do the same thing, right? That makes maybe take some tension off your lower back, okay? One of my favorite ones to do. We can do an abbreviated version of what that lady was doing on the desk and just put your foot up on your chair and put it back down again a couple of times. If you want to try that. And what's nice about a chair is you can put one finger on it and balance. Just like that. Good, like most of you can do it. And then of course the other leg. Some of you are like, can't reach the chair? Jump, you've got to jump.
So you can,
you'll be in better shape than the rest of us. Upper extremity, my favorite one right there is just standing at attention. Most of us are working all day long with our hands in front. Most of our athletes here, who I'm dealing with quite a bit, hands in front. Okay? I can't think of any that work with their hands behind their back. They probably won't be here for very long. So just put your hands behind your back, clasp your hands together, and just stand there. You feel that? Is that it just kind of opens you up. It's one of the simplest things that we can do, and it's really effective. And if you're talking to somebody, hi, how are you? It's nice to see you. And if everybody's doing it, it's not so awkward.
That must be why they make, that's the military parade rest.
Yeah. You know, I've watched people pass out standing at parade rest, which is kind of exciting, because they lock their knees, and they try not to move.
Passing out on the
and their pants are so starched that they can see every little movement you make. And if you don't do a little bob with your knees, they'll pass out because of the circulation issue. Yeah, we went to New Mexico Military Academy with the football, and they're at parade rest. And I guess they got in trouble because they were standing there a long time. And by the time we got done getting our athletes ready, there was about four of them laying on the ground. And they'd walk out and check them and leave them. Yeah, really, they left. Step over, go to the next guy. So this is just a simple thing to do. You can just reach back. If you want to make it a little more difficult, you can just lift your hands off your back and put them back down again. If anyone tears a rotator cuff, let me know. We can do that. You can reach further down. You can reach up.
Yeah,
it's hard, huh? It's because we're forward posture people. So to reach up, some of us are like, what? Technically, you should be able to touch your shoulder blades with your thumbs. Some of you are missing that.
How long can I grow my nails?
Yeah, you got to grow your nails pretty long. Okay, so just up and down. So parade rest and then up and down helps a little bit. And you can do that seated as well. Okay? Oh, you want to sit down and try these? And now, I know that these don't have arms on them, but that's okay. So you can sit down and just do leg extensions. You can do this at your desk while you're reading an email. Anyone ever try to put the mouse on their knee? Okay, you can take it off the desk. It's not stuck there. It's not permanent. Put it on your leg. It works just fine. They've gotten rid of little roller balls on them. Remember those? How long ago was that?
Yeah.
Okay, and just do leg extensions. Once again, just increasing circulation, getting a little bit of blood flow going. Works wonders. You can also do a step up with them, like this. If you want to make it really challenging, get off the seat. Oh, man, where did that come from, huh? Okay, if you don't like that, lean back. Everyone's all leaning back. Okay, because leaning forward is a lot harder. Okay, if you really want to get crazy, you can pick your foot up and tap your knee with it. I can only do that with my right.
I'll break something.
Okay, so do you remember before junior high how much we loved recess? And then we get to junior high and we don't do recess anymore? Guess when obesity issues are creeping into our culture? About that age, okay, in the 13-ish. And I think it has less to do with hormones and less to do with the idea that we're not exercising, okay? All right, this one over here on the right, he's got an arm, but you can do that just off the chair, just push up. And all we're doing is we're just shrugging, we're doing an opposite of a shrug. All day long, we're bringing our shoulders and getting closer to our ears, okay, all day long. I can see some of you doing this already. So by doing this, and we're just depressing down, we're pressing our shoulders down into the chair through our hands. That's just the opposite motion, and it works wonders throughout the day. If you have carpal tunnel, maybe not so good to push on the chair. That's going to hurt. That's going to hurt. Okay, so just a few ideas. If we can change the what our desk look like as far as where our work is, if we can change the positioning of our chair. Some of us, and even these desks do it, it looks like they come up and they can lower. I know some of you have the desks that actually raise up so that you can stand at your workstation. By making those changes, and sometimes they're small changes, you can make a huge change in your productivity. And that's great for those who are counting the beans. But it really pays off for you physically, too, because you'll feel a lot better. So even today, you can make a few changes. You can go back to your desk and say, all right, what can I do? Can I raise that up a little bit? And it really is about comfort. And you may not have even thought to make those changes. And hopefully today you've thought to make a few of those changes. You know, you can stand for this if you want, but all I can just show you. If you have room to do this, I know that many of us are working in an office space where there's lots of people around, and it may feel a little bit awkward to stand up and do this type of yoga pose. And it can either be done with two hands or you can do it with one. And the idea is to reach down and reach up at the same time. And you can do it all day long if you want. You can do the other side if you want. As we get older, a few of us go hands over head. Okay? We don't do it much. We just don't. Look at the faces you're making. Okay? Go home and put your favorite dishes a little bit higher. All right? Please. Because if you don't, you're going to get older. I almost said an age, and I won't do that to you. You're going to get older, and then we're going to see you in the clinic because now your rotator cuff isn't working like you want it to. Okay? So get your hands up. Make sure we're getting hands up. That's what that one's for. And please, use the stairs. We have lots of them. Right? Use the stairs. Or that really cool ramp that they're building that they'll finish here in a couple of weeks down over here by the
Fine Arts.
Okay? Use a ramp. Use the stairs. And it's not down the stairs. It's up the stairs. That really is good. Okay? And by all means, get out and talk to people. Instead of maybe sending an email to the person right next to you, maybe go up and talk to them and have maybe write it down and hand them a note. Okay, and maybe go across the hall or send the email because it may be something that you want to keep as a record. And then go say, hey, I just sent you an email. Did you get it? Yeah, I got it. Hey, how's your day going? You know, let's talk and let's associate and say, hey, how are you feeling? You want to come up and we can do some toe raises together? I'm just kidding. But you can encourage that. Hey, you got 15 minutes. You want to walk around the building real quick? Let's talk about what we need to do. And maybe make those meetings that we have to have, we feel like we don't have any time for, use that as an opportunity to go ahead and walk and move. We've got a wonderful campus. You know, do a lap around the administration building when you're having a meeting. Or Or if a student comes to you in your office, instead of sitting there and talking to them why their grades stink, get up and walk with them and say, hey, let's go for a walk and let's talk about why your grades stink. And let's see what we can do to help you get better. And actually move while you do it. There's studies that show that it actually that increase in blood flow is going to help you think better. It's going to be more memorable to that student or to your associate that you actually went for a walk and discussed things. So let's move. Let's incorporate exercise and movement a little bit more into our workplace. And that's going to help quite a bit, one, for our productivity, and two, to make us feel a lot better. Do you guys have any questions for me? That would depend on your vision, honestly. And I think most of the time we tend to get too close to our monitors. And that's another topic when we talk about visual field and how much light we're letting in and not seeing any background. So if all you can see are your screens, and some of you have two screens, are we going to go surround sound sometime too? Yeah. So you know what I mean? And I understand why. I'm teasing you, but I understand why. But when you lose perspective beyond that and into the distance, especially if you have a wall right behind your desk, that is a lot harder. And they're looking at actually anxiety issues with that as well as the ability to focus away and focus back and use the muscles in your eyes. So, you know, you don't want to be a mouse in a closed box. So to answer your question, it just depends on if you feel like you have eye strain during the day and that eye strain comes from just staring at one distance and not being able to look and see further away and then back and changing that perspective.
I was told about arm's length.
Yeah, typically.
I have one question on how's your wrist supposed to be positioned on the keyboard?
Slightly flexed.
Like mine's like this and it.
Yeah, slightly flexed. When you go into extension is when you put stress to the carpal tunnel. So it's just.
I have mine kind of down, so I need to be more like that.
Yeah, and we've built small pads to go up. I've seen wrist supports where they actually just cocks the wrist up. That's fine. But if you can get the elbow to follow, that's even better. But the problem is if you go too high, then we start to get elevation here. So what's really hard is to lower a desk, which was what we really need to do because they're all built fairly standard. And our legs are built fairly standard too, so it's not like we can get up and over the top. But yeah, slightly flexed is where we want.
Mine's like this.
Yeah, you don't want to do that. You can get a keyboard and turn it like this, then it solves everybody's problem. Yeah. Keyboards are fairly easy modification, so even the split ones will help that because when you split, it's hard to stay in an extended position, so they almost force you to come back down, and they'll just a pad. We start with, like I said, we start simple just to see if it'll work. We'll put towels, just have them rest with a towel. We use a lot of tape and towels and just tape things in position, not on their arms necessarily, although that might be a bad idea.
You know,
I'm at work and you're all taped up. Got a lumbar support wrapped around you. Doesn't matter where I sit, I'm ready to go. Anybody else? Everyone's thinking about their desk at this point, thinking, what can I do to fix that? But you can. And just make little adjustments at a time. Don't try to fix the seat and the desk and do one thing and see how it feels and say, okay, then maybe what about my feet? And then do that and fix one thing at a time. And it usually comes. It'll make you more comfortable, and comfort's really where we're at. Once again, though, you can't spend all day there. You have to get up and you have to move. So, and some of us, I mean, we're just stuck in a spot.
Walk to the bathroom in the other building.
There you go, or run, as the case may be, whatever. You gotta walk.
It doesn't matter what bathroom I go in, but I try to walk.
Yeah.
Even if it's 5 minutes.
That may be the only solution if you're. And you know what? Space is space, and they have to put things a certain way, and they don't. I mean, if they had considered it, even if they had considered it and put a desk that could be changed around, you're still gonna be just because of your repetitive of motion. It's gonna be tough. Most of us.
Tough, especially in the summer when we're working the longer hours.
Yeah.
It's ridiculously.
Yeah. All right, anybody else? We're good? Okay, that's all I've got. Thanks for coming, and I hope you learned something.